Hello guys, how you doing? This is JP Saricolia, and once again coming to you with another review. And this time I want to explore or go back a little more into the 90s. Well, as you can see, this is the first part that I would recommend for anybody that wants to start knowing more about the characters, about Cable, and introduction of Cable and the New Mutants. You see the X-Force right here logo. You see this with the new colors. Cable and the New Mutants, and you have, of course, Simonson, Louis Simonson, which was involved in the writing and plotting of the New Mutants, Liefeld. You can see the classic goes to war and collect the New Mutants 86 to 94, an annual number 5. I like the colors here. I like the new colors. All right, now without the dust jacket, you can see, the book. And I really love this, actually, this binding. It was very high quality binding, X-Force, Cable, New Mutants. It had like a feeling of course, this is not leather, but it has a feeling of leather of classic books. You can see on the side, X-Force, Cable, and the New Mutants, Simonson, Liefeld, and there's nothing in the back. I always like this, this panel. I think this is one of the times where I feel that Liefeld was actually working properly the pencils. But here you can see the writers, Louis Simonson, Fabian DeCiesa, Dwight Zimmerman. In pencilers, of course, Rob Liefeld, Bob Hall. You have inkers, special credit to Hilary Barda. You got Bob Wysick, Jeff Albrecht, and Tim Zahn. Colorists, you see more people there. Letterers, of course. All right, here you have the first time Liefeld gets involved into the project, and this is New Mutants number 86. I definitely like this, always like this, actually, cover. This is some of those times where actually you saw, although not perfect, I would say, I see that there was some, that Liefeld had some ability to his drawings. As you can see, Rob Liefeld. I like the way he did, in this case, the Vulture. And actually, this cover is Liefeld and McFarlane. McFarlane, I think, is doing the inking for the young Liefeld. Let's do some history on this. And Liefeld started very, very young in the industry. You might have heard of him, the infamous Rob Liefeld. Some people love him, some people hate him, and for many, many reasons. I personally, like I said, I'm in the middle. I'm undecided, and I think I will always be undecided in regards to him as an artist. I think he had potential, and you know, if you read a lot of the commentary or people that they knew him personally, people that actually gave him a chance, he was very young when he decided to go into comics. He was a teenager, hell-bent into get into comics. So He did everything. He had charisma. You know, he was looking around. He was sending, you know, his work everywhere. Most people will tell you they did saw in him potential. Potential. His anatomy was a bit off. That's what they said. But his storytelling was very clear. And you can see that. He said that he followed a lot of the sequential type of work that actually George Perez does. Because, you know, he said it many times. He loved George Perez. I like this here. As you can see, skits. Definitely, you can see an angle. You can see the perspective well made. So definitely, you know, he had potential, and he, you know, and there were times where actually his art was a spot on. I think it was definitely it where he's supposed to be. But there were times where actually you can turn a page where he does really good work, and then all of a sudden you turn to the following page, and it's just horrendous. You know, the work wasn't there. Like it was just made, you know, like without, you know, he was trying to, you know, hit the deadline, and at the last minute he just drew whatever. And but regardless of it, you know, people loved them. You know, here you can see this, the introduction of Cable, very now iconic cover. And there's times where there's some, you know, the panels are lively. There are times where his work is done. And there are times where the work is not there. You know, there's everything you have heard about him, you know, when it comes about this perspective is wrong, anatomy is off, you know, clean panels, you know, where there's not much work done, no detail. Yeah, he did it all. Everything that you're not supposed to do. And some people will defend and say, hey, you know, he just was breaking the rules, which is true. You know, he was very young. And I think the fame that he gathered through all of this, you know, really kind of, well, I wouldn't say affect him, but, you know, it does have an effect in what you do. And Warlock, never really, I was never crazy about the guy. Strife, as you can see right there, it's off, but he introduced the character as well. Let's recap a little bit and talk about more than New Mutants. New Mutants was a spinoff that it started actually from the X-Men back in the early 80s. During that time, the X-Men was so popular that that you know, the Jim Shooter, who was the editor-in-chief from Marvel, decided to create a spin-off. So they needed a different spin-off that throughout the 80s and later during the 90s you saw from the X-Men. So the first one they did, the device was to create the New Mutants or do something like that. So he ordered, in this case, Chris Claremont and Louise Simonson, who was the, an editor in Marvel, to create a character. They were not really keen about it, but they did it because, you know, that's what the demand was, and they came up with the New Mutants, actually, that was presented in, and if you remember, there was a small series that was discontinued. I think there only were four chapters of what is called Marvel graphic novels. So of course, Marvel was trying to also get into the graphic novel craze that was going on during the 80s, where DC was really racking money and was doing well. So they wanted to create something in those lines. So of course, from that line, you remember the New Mutants, the introduction of them, and one of them is the death of Captain Marvel, which is also been considered a historic book for many. Which many have considered that was the end of the Bronze Age of comics into what is later on was considered, you know, it's considered the Dark Ages or the ages of the 80s and 90s. The New Mutants was, you know, was created at the beginning. It was a bit popular, and of course it started changing direction, and there was a lot of mysticism, a lot of things. It was completely different from what the X-Men were, the Uncanny X-Men. So, you know, sometimes it was good, sometimes it was bad. There were many changes. It was like the X-Men younger version again, but they have a lot of it. I think Chris Claremont was not really as into it and as much. He experimented with a lot of stories that were a bit off and actually push you know, readers away because they didn't feel comfortable with it. And here you can see a gallery of the previous or former members of this. You have Karma, you have Moonstar, which is became an Asgardian Valkyrie, and you have also Magma, Bird Boy, and of course you have Magic, the sister of course Colossus and Cypher. Many of them, they die or they were killed out of the story for one reason or the other, because they were not popular among the readers. And of course, so the New Mutants went into, for a while, for many years, it struggled through sales. Louise Simonson became, after Chris left, she became the writer of the story, one of the stories that she was keeping up during that time. And Louise Simonson, if you know her, she is the wife of the great Walt Simonson. Louise, in her own right, has been a great motor in the creation of characters, not only for Marvel, but also within the DC 80s and 90s, primarily in the 90s with DC, but stories. And you start stories like Power Pack, X-Factor. She was involved with X-Factor. She created characters like Apocalypse. So she's so involved into the story. During those years, there was a lot of struggles, you know, with artists trying to really stay afloat. And sometimes things were good, sometimes things were not as good. So it was dying in popularity among readers. And it was until they brought the young Liefeld to work with this. And as you can see right here, look at this Boom Boom in this panel. She looks gorgeous there. So definitely, you know, you can see there's times where his art is good, and then there's times when it goes off. But here it's not bad. I think he was very, very good at it at the beginning. I actually like his New Mutants stuff more than I did the X-Force stuff. I felt that in New Mutants there's potential. But he picked up that to a point where people were so attracted to his thing. You know, he were attracted to the energy. You know, he was young. He was in his early 20s. So he was pumping stuff, doing stuff. I like this variant cover of the same, you know, cover of the introduction of Cable. And, you know, he became so popular. You know, it's just, there was times where, you know, he did great, and there's times where everything was a bit off. You know, unbelievable, you know, but, you know, he became, I think in many ways they say that, you know, that people say that he had that energy, that being a young person, and I think that's one of the reasons why a lot of people kind of follow his work. He had a lot of followers during those years, because people saw his ability, people saw his desire, his passion. He represented a younger generation of many younger readers that now they saw themselves represented in someone like them that was a fan of comics, that was getting into comics, and was breaking rules. And he got the support, you know, right away. This is actually the cover in the front. I really like this cover. It's not as bad. I definitely do. You can see, and this we have Zeke characters. There's times when he does this, which throws you off a bit. Always, I've always done that. I've never been a fan. I don't think most people are fans of this, the landscape, the view. But you can see Sabretooth, Caliban. You know, we're going through the Morlocks in the tunnels. There are times where his art is good. You know, there's times where you feel like, man, you know, if he really puts him into it. But there's times with the anatomy, like here, you can see how elongated everything is. You know, definitely out of, you know, the anatomy is off. And that's just a small presentation. You can go and see others where actually everything is even a lot worse. So, yeah, there are times where, but I think with the New Mutants, he was still kind of testing waters, and he was doing good in his panels. You know, I think there was some flow. And people love that, you know, as long as you can tell the story, whether, you know, the pencil is good. I think what people really love was the story in itself. And I think that has to do with a lot of credit with, in this case, Simonson. I think people love Weezy's work. Although I'm going to say that a lot of people, they have always found Louise as very worthy. But she comes from the same school of Chris Claremont, who is worthy. And if you look at that, he creates so many words. That's one of the reasons why John Byrne hated to work with Chris during the years with the X-Men, because he felt that he complicated, this Chris complicated his drawings, you know, by all these words that he put into stuff. So they have issues going on. But you can see here, here is some more bigger panels. There's some work there. I think that there is some life there. There's some passion there. There are times where, like I said, you know, there are times where everything seems to be okay. Like this, it's not a bad close-up of a Cable. It looks pretty good there. Doesn't look that bad. And we can go. I'm going a little faster. As you can see, Keek really revived this where people were really loving it, and actually he would start selling more. People wanted more of Liefeld. I've always liked this panel, like I said in the beginning. I think it's one of the times where you can see Rob as really being very consistent with the work, which, you know, it's an oxymoron in one way for many people. You know, it's like how Rob can be consistent there. But he was, you know, there. You know, you can see that when he got his mind to it, he would do it. And also the inking is a big part. And like I said, Hilary Barda, who was involved into the inking, she did good, you know. But there's times like this, for example. Well, there's so much you can do, you know, and you can see the background, so, you know, there's empty. There's no real sense of horizon, you know, and I'm going to go to this point. Sunfire. I always like the design of this character, this Japanese character. Very cool. But here is what I'm going to show you, something where I feel that you'll get what I'm saying. You see this panel. As soon as you see it, you see Sunspot on one side, and then you see Cable on this side. At first glance, you might think that, you know, Cable is a giant right next to Sunspot, because that's the first impression. And the problem here is that there is no perspective. If you ever understand, if you know comics, so I would recommend you to actually get the How to Draw Comics the Marvel Way, which was a bestseller back in the 70s created, and there's actually videos for it, because they created a videos, you know, series for it. Well, it was, in this case, by, of course, Stan Lee was involved in the project, and Buscema was doing the drawing. They talk about perspective. It's a great, great book. And perspective is an extremely important part of comic books and the comic book creation. What is the perspective? It's your eye level. Where your eyes go in the background, it will reflect your point of view, how you see things. So if you create perspective, you can create dimensions in a way with, and you have to go to a horizon line. The horizon line is your eye level. So when you see the horizon line, everything is built upon that in a way that you can see everything with perspective in a three-dimensional way. When you don't have that, when you don't do it properly, and that's what all the masters of the art know how to do, you might not see the line, but the line is there. When you draw that way, it's easier to see everything with perspective, with the right scale and the right angle. If not, everything matches together and everything is lost. You don't know what's up, what's down, you don't know what's closer, what's nearer, what's farther away. So that's the problem there. The only thing that gives it away here is the fact that his feet is there, and even that feet so small that, you know, honestly, you know, just the anatomy there off. So yeah, all of that, you know, he's guilty as charged of all the things that he's been accused. And of course, over time he has improved over the years, but he was so infamous during that time. And then when he went to Youngblood, which was even worse, when you realize the most artists, you know, they improve over time, you know, they get better. When you see the art of people like Jim Lee or many artists, even Jack Kirby, when you see them in their start, you know, they have their, they still shake in some areas, but over time the art improves, you know, that it gets better. Look at this. I like the face of Wolverine there. So it improves, it gets better. You know, it's just the way it is. And here you can see this part. Ralph Leifer still working here. Definitely, that's one of the things that, you know, once over, you know, over time things improve. But if you're not improving, then there's a problem. And there's one, two things. Maybe you cannot improve. Maybe you're getting worse. Maybe it's, or simply you just don't want to do it. And it's easier to think that that was the case. That, you know, once the fame became so part of his life, you know, people saying that you, when people are start, you know, always praising what you do, even when it's not good, then you just become lazy about it, you know. And that's one of the accusations he always had, not only by fans, but also by many, many artists within the industry. But regardless of, you know, there was popularity, he was very popular, and you know, you couldn't stop that, you know, and he had the support and he was selling. And at the end of the day, you know, the publishers like Marvel or DC are going to just do, give what customers want, and whether it's good or whether it's bad. But, you know, I think that was it, you know, and this actually kind of not culminates everything that he was done with the New Mutants. Because after this, actually, the New Mutants had a new, there was a crossover, which is the Extinction Agenda, where actually there were three chapters, I think, and those chapters are actually crossover this before you go to what is the X-Force Omnibus, which I'm going to review next. But definitely, I would say this is, if you want to get, there's no Deadpool here, of course, but this is the beginning. This is what Cable is introduced. This is what actually the stories will start developing. This is what actually Rob Liefeld becomes very popular in within Marvel, you know. And you know, he started getting steam and popularity, and people are liking, and they start buying the New Mutants again, and people are seeing his art, and he start creating a buzz through X-Force. Definitely that will become X-Force. And then of course he left and to do his own project with Image Comics, with the other creators that left to create Image Comics. So do I recommend this? Definitely it's just it's hard to tell. Unless you are a Rob Liefeld fan, or you love Cable and the New Mutants and the X-Force, if you're a history buff with comics from the 90s, definitely you should have it. If you like the X-Force, it should be the start of the X-Force collection of your books. If you don't like Rob Liefeld, this is not going to change your mind. It's not going to make it better. It's not going to make you feel or appreciate what he has done or his work or the what happened after he left Marvel, which we will talk about more when I review the Omnibus. But yes, but it's not going to change it. It's only if you are a fan of that time era or those comics or him as a person, as an artist, then definitely it is. But for the mass majority of the people, definitely there's much better collections, much better art somewhere else. Not saying that his art was bad, because I think he has energy. There was passion involved in it. The stories are a bit, you know, it's 90s stories, you know, so there's a lot of, you know, fighting, a lot of pouching, and a lot of, you know, things that, you know, even the scripts are a bit, you know, cheesy. But definitely, if you are a fan, I would recommend to look at it, to look at this, you know, this collection, this book. I'm sure this you can find it for cheap, and it's up to you. Well, so once again, thank you for watching this video, and I'll see you on the next one. Take care, my friends. God bless.